guys. We're getting started. Welcome. This is the Rails 3, RSpec 2, and Cucumber Code Immersion. I've taught a couple classes about learning Rails and RSpec and Cucumber, but for this, we're trying a new format, which is basically we're just going to code an application and have you guys follow along. And by the process of osmosis, at the end of the day, you will be Epic Rails 3 developers. So, it's automatic.
It's over here.
Now I'm like, can you guys still hear me?
Yeah.
And I'm like one of those motivational speakers. Like, okay, so just quickly show of hands here. Raise your hand if you've coded Rails 2 or 3. Okay, raise your hand if you have not, because that'll be simpler. Okay, how many Cucumber or RSpec newbies here? Okay, about half. So, well, oh shoot, we forgot the power. Do you want to get the power? Yeah. All right. So we're gonna start the whole thing from scratch, and today we will be writing a Twitter clone in Ruby, because Twitter originally started in Ruby, and then they had trouble scaling, so they rewrote it in Scala and got the benefit of the knowledge of a rewrite. So given Twitter's trouble making money at this point, we will rewrite again in Ruby and hopefully solve some of those problems. So, and BJ is in charge of scaling, right, BJ?
That's right.
He is our scaling engineer. So to get started, just to make things easy, I have already created a gem set, an RVM gem set of the different gems that we're going to be using in the immersion today. So if you go to this URL, can you guys see that? If you go to this URL, that will redirect you to a pasty that contains the list of gems that we're going to use. You should be able to just copy that to a local file and then do an RVM gem set import if you're using RVM. But I'm not going to show the instructions for that, since every version of RVM is slightly different on this and I always have trouble. But there you go. That will kind of help get started. We're also going to use Bundler built into Rails, so that will install automatically, but this will just kind of get you started faster. So. So first thing, I've got my...
used RVM?
Oh yeah, have you guys all used RVM? Has anybody here not used RVM?
We got a Windows guy.
We have a Windows guy.
He's never done any Ruby at all.
Really? Yeah. This is going to be awesome. Oh, here's the other thing I wanted to say. We're pair programming. Who here has pair programmed before?
Woo!
All right, we got some fans back there. I love it. So BJ and I are going to start off pairing on this thing, but I want to do sort of a fishbowl format, and the fishbowl thing is where basically somebody can come up and kick one of us off and pair with the other one. So if you're feeling bold, or if you want to really immerse yourself in this stuff, at any point, come on up. You know, the first person who stands over here when we get to a good stopping point, one of us will get up and hang out for a while the other two guys code, and then, you know, we'll swap out a little bit. So first thing, BJ has our gem set installed, so he's going to create a new Rails application with Rails new, and then the name of the application. So in this case, what do we want to call it? Twitter. Twitter 2.0 for Twitter 2.0. Yes, I like it.
What was the Rails new thing?
So this is Rails 3. Rails new creates a new Rails application. In Rails version 2, there was a whole set of scripts, you know, like script generate, script runner, script server, all that stuff. Now there's a single binary, well, single script called Rails, and then it takes arguments to it. So new creates a new application. Server will kick off a server. Console will kick off a console. Nope, sorry, that was just because he, you would say Rails new, Ruby web, conf. No, it was when we just did Rails New, it was just showing the documentation for it. Okay, so now let's go into the Ruby WebConf directory.
Twitter 2,
right? And now we are going, let's open that in TextMate because we need to set up our gems. And if I don't know if you guys have all seen Bundler yet. Bundler is the new gem management thing. Use gem file. There's a gem file here, which you see this configures all the gems for the different environments you're going to use, and it can it takes versions. It can actually hook into Git, as you see an example on line 6. Kind of cool. So this is where you set up the gems, and we specify the gems in here and then run a single command, and it'll install all the gems that we need. So we're going to need Cucumber Rails. Command Shift Plus. Is that good in the back? Can you guys read that, or still a little bigger?
One more.
Uno más. How's that? Back corner, your farthest. Cool. Okay, so we also need RSpec Rails. And RSpec is still in development 2.0. Yeah, here's the version number. It's in beta. 2.0 is in beta, so it hasn't been officially released yet. And it's only compatible with with Rails 3. So we need to specify the version there to get RSpec 2 beta. We also want Fixture, which is our test data builder. You will see it is incredibly superior to Factory Girl. And Capybara, which have you guys used WebRat before for kind of like clicking around and submitting forms and stuff? WebRat, unfortunately, does not work for Rails 3 yet, so we're using Capybara, although Capybara is pretty cool because it hooks into things like Celerity and stuff better. Okay, so once we've got that saved, we will need to have Bundler installed, and so that's just a simple gem install Bundler, which I think we already have at this point. But so if you don't have Bundler installed, you'll need to install Bundler, and then finally we say bundle install, and that looks at the gem file, figures out all the gems, including the dependencies, apparently figures out versioning problems, and installs all the gems that we need.
This takes a long time.
So while we're doing that, can you go back to what the gems were? Exactly.
Yep.
Hey, John.
How you doing?
Cool. Okay. Yeah, and why don't we paste you this gem file for anybody who's not a... Should have done that one before. Ooh, and Twitter that. There we go. Using the RubyConf hashtag.
Actually, I'll throw that in the back channel. If you're
in
IRC, go to RubyWebConf, and we'll make sure it's there as well.
Okay, cool.
That means this is just a ploy to get everybody following Pat.
Yes, I am Pat Maddox in real life and GitHub and Twitter. Okay, so once we've got our gems installed, next up we are going to want to generate RSpec and Cucumber. That is, Rails 3 has Rails 3 actually is more test framework agnostic than Rails 2 was. So basically all the generators have hooks in them now. So if you set up RSpec, then when you generate a model or you generate a controller, go ahead and install RSpec, it will actually generate RSpec files for you instead of test unit and whatever test framework you want to use. So we also want to install Cucumber, but don't hit enter, because when we do it, we need to set it up with Capybara and RSpec. You can, if you don't want to use RSpec, you can do test unit or test unit as part of the Cucumber generation. This is basically just for the assertions that you use in your Cucumber step definitions. You know, you can say that something should include something, or you can use assert if you want to use test unit. So because we're using RSpec for the unit testing, we will use it for our for Cucumber as well. So we tell it to, we tell Cucumber to generate and install with Capybara and RSpec. And you look, see it created this features directory for us along with an empty step definitions. Well, actually it gave us web steps, which is Capybara's default steps in there. And then it also set up a database, something in database YAML for us. So let's take a look at features. We see the environment file. This is what's generated. You pretty much don't edit this file because it'll get generated by Cucumber every time you want to. So like if you upgrade Cucumber and you want to regenerate, then it'll overwrite this file. So you can either spend a lot of time looking at diffs, or you can, you know, just not edit it and put a file in, under support.
Anything in support gets required.
Actually, any Ruby files under features get automatically required. So if it's under there, like the step definitions get loaded, support gets loaded. This is all, and you can set up Cucumber profiles, so you can write tests that will that will go kind of through Rails at the controller level, I guess. And then you can set up another profile to actually run that in the browser using something like Selenium. So that way you can write one set of acceptance tests using Cucumber and run them relatively quickly at the app level, but then a lot more slowly at the browser level. And that can actually hook into Celerity too, which lets you run JavaScript stuff headless. So this is the basic setup that you're going to do when you start a new Rails 3 app if you want to use Cucumber. And if you want to use Cucumber and RSpec, if you don't want to use RSpec, you take out the RSpec install step, and same thing with Cucumber. But nifty tools, so we're going to use them to drive our stuff. I think let's start off with just making sure that our Cucumber stuff is set up well by writing a really simple feature that like hits the home page and you know, allows us to, we'll just view some text on the home page, make sure everything's hooked up.
Oh, can you do that?
You can. You can do RailsG Cucumber colon feature. So Cucumber gives you some generators. We'll just call this view home page.
Do I need the camel case?
I have no clue. I would never use the feature generator.
Yeah.
Okay. See, it's called Manage View Home Pages. How hideous is that? Oh my god.
Wow.
Oh my god. Oh my gosh. delete that. Okay, there you go. Okay. So let's just say visiting the home page and get rid of the whole in order to stuff. So for those not familiar with Cucumber, the structure is basically you define there are individual feature files. This is plain text. It gets mapped to Ruby code. You define step definitions that basically map it to your application code. So it's cool. Why don't we call it something that makes sense, like visiting the home page? OK, and we'll say, when I go to the home page, then I should see, yay, it works. All right, cool. So we can go ahead and run that.
Can I do auto test or?
I don't use auto test for Cucumber really.
Okay.
So I would just. Run it? I don't know if that works.
That didn't work.
Run it from there. Just run Cucumber. Just Cucumber. Cucumber features. Well, that works too. Okay, so we see that. I want to show something. Why don't you change one of the steps, like given I go to the fancy homepage, something that won't match?
Yeah.
Okay, actually, I want to say when I. Check it out. That doesn't make any sense, but. Okay, so Cucumber, when you write these different steps, these plain text steps, like I said, it maps it to your Ruby code, and it does it by using these step definitions. when we generated it with Capybara, some of the step definitions were created for us automatically. And those step definitions are held under step definition slash web steps. And you see there's some things like given I am on, and I go to, and I press, and I follow, I fill in, I click, I choose, I should see some text. These are basic, kind of lowish level step definitions that you're going to use that say, like, I'm on a certain page, I fill out this form, I submit the form, then I should see this text. So the way we wrote this initial feature, we don't have to do any, we don't have to write any of the step definitions yet, because Cucumber just kind of already knows about those. So what we do have is it's visiting the home page, and it should have this content on it. Yeah, it works, but it doesn't, right? So all we're going to do is hook up a home page so that we can make sure that kind of our full stack of Cucumber and RSpec are working. So first thing we got to do is remove the index file, the public index file. And then we'll want a new controller for our home page, right? And I usually call it like main controller, but I know that you don't like that. What do you want to call it? Don't put controller on it, because it'll append controller to it. It'll do main controller controller. OK. It's main controller spec. Let's start off with that. Cool. So we're going to start off writing a spec that just says that the main controller works. So we're just going to get the home action and assert that it includes the text that we want. So it shows, yay, it works on the home page. Get home. Response. That's it. Say response body should include. That's going to need to be in parentheses. Cool. Oh, yeah, and let's get autotest. But actually, I want to set up autotest growl real quick. Have you guys used autotest? It's a little tool that basically looks at the files that you're changing and automatically runs your test for you every time they change. So that's really cool. And that's done by using the gem install autotest, which I think I included in the RVM gem bundle dump. And then if you want to hook it into growl, there's autotest growl gem, and then you have to edit this autotest file to require autotest growl. Okay. So now when I run autotest, all right, cool. So you see that every time, well, we'll see what happens, but when we run a test, it's going to show up in here. So problem is no route matches. So OK, let's get started and put that in routes. So we just want to say, like, get main home, main hash.
You want a hash?
I do, yes.
That?
No. That's a hash rocket. It's not even a, why is that called a hash rocket? There's no hash in there. Isn't that a hash? It's a hash, right?
That's a pound. Hash.
It's a pound. Well, they call it hash in England because pounds mean something else. Sharp we have. Could not run the test. All right, we totally broke it. That means I got the formatting, the something wrong. Default controller in action, missing controller. Oh, you know what?
So you do a hash rocket to
the root?
Oh, you're right. So I want to say
the main pound home.
Yeah, well, root 2, right? Can I do this? Main home. How are we doing? The action home could not be found. Okay, cool. So now if we go to our main controller, we'll say home. Now, I take really small steps when I do test-driven development. So when it tells me that the error is the action home could not be found for main controller, instead of trying to make this pass, even though it's going to be a one-liner and stupid simple, I like to take these baby steps and follow Brian Lyle's thing of change the message or make it pass, right? So all you need to do is, so when I get a test error, then I can look at that to figure out what the next step is. And that basically gives me really small problems to work with at any given point. And you know, I can figure out small problems. Like it says, there's no home action. Well, all I need to do is define that. So you're gonna wanna set up an RVMRC if you're going to open new directories like this. So every time you go in.
What do you do with the other terminal?
That is the terminal. Okay, hang on. Okay, cool. We've got our gem set up. What
do we want to make the home action?
No, I don't. We just want to render some text straight from the home controller. Okay. So it said that the home template didn't exist, but all I'm trying to see is that the text is there. So we can render it straight from the controller. And hey, look, we're passing. So now we're just doing a really, really simple example here, so you probably wouldn't need to start off with Cucumber and then go down into RSpec to test the lower level stuff and then go back up to Cucumber to check that it all works. But that's the pattern we're going to be following, so I wanted to introduce it on something simple. So if we run Cucumber, we should see, okay, we've got our homepage set up. So what we've figured out now is that we've been able to install Rails, get Cucumber and RSpec all set up. So basically, our environment is all set up to do some hardcore TDD as we build out the new features. Yeah.
Can you guys do a git commit, push this up to GitHub, so people can kind of catch up?
It's exactly what we're going to be doing right now.
Sweetness.
Git init.
You want to review it or just commit it all?
Just commit it all. I'll let you guys figure out the database stuff. Okay.
You want to go on GitHub?
Yeah. Isn't there like a GitHub gem that will automatically create it for me?
Probably.
Oh, wait. Ruby web comp. All right, so the little bit of work that we've done so far. Oh, wait, I did not push that out, obviously.
Are you tweeting that, or what?
I did just tweet that. So all the stuff that we're going to be doing, like if I've got information to share like that, we will be sure to tweet it using the Ruby WebConf hashtag, and then that way you can just follow that. Or as BJ said, you can follow my Twitter account, Pat Maddox, and you will find everything too. Okay, so if we go check this out. All right, cool. Should be all set up there. If you want to git clone, if you want to go to that URL, clone it, then it has all the stuff that we've done. So now that we're ready to start building this, BJ's more of the...
You got like 2 minutes.
2 minutes? Well, in that case, I think we should just be at a stopping point and field any questions, although, you know, I don't know, questions? We basically just installed this setup environment. So now, in the next session, we'll be able to build our features and do it really quickly and at a high level of quality since we'll have all our testing in place.
Can you show the gem file again?
Yeah. The gem file is... right here. And I think that should be under the... We Twittered that too, right? Tweeted that.
Tweeted that.
Cool. So any questions here? Next session, we'll get right into building up all the features. We're probably gonna start off with users and messages, since that's sort of the core thing of Cucumber, or sorry, of Twitter. But at this point, any questions about the setup or you know how we did the Cucumber and RSpec stuff? Yeah?
Could you show the GitHub URL again, please?
Yes. GitHub.com/PatMaddox/RubyWebConf. Dude, it's already on Twitter.
Now we're gonna have all things.
Now we have it all there. Oh, and we can just git check out when we're done, huh? Anything else at this point?
Yeah, the test environment and your auto test. Show that again, how you.
Oh yeah, okay. So to get auto test running, you want to do gem install auto test, and that's it. Actually, if you have auto test installed before you generate RSpec and Cucumber, then it will it'll set everything up for you automatically. If you install it after the fact, then you need to create and edit this auto test /discover.rb file and tell it that it knows about Rails and it knows about RSpec too. And this way AutoTest knows how to handle these. Okay. So once you install.
What was in your .autotest file?
I'll show that in a minute. Okay. So this is AutoTest /discover.rb. And then in my .autotest file, this was so that I could get growl notification working. And in this case, you just require AutoTest growl. That requires you to gem install auto test growl. And now, when we kick off auto test, instead of having to look at the window every time for feedback, it'll pop up a growl notification for us. Cool, so that's it for now. I guess in 2 hours, we are back on session 2 here, in which we will begin developing the actual features for our Twitter clone. Thanks.
Okay, we're gonna get started again with the Twitter 2.0 app as soon as Pat closes all of his applications.
Okay, cool.
Did anybody have any problems getting the app running that tried to? Has anybody tried to get it running yet? That we pushed? Maybe not. Okay. Well, hit it. Come up to us and ask if you have some issues, if you want to try to get this running on your machine or whatever. It should be pretty easy with Bundler, but there's always edge cases and stuff that weird setups people have. So, okay, so basically we don't have, we have our environment set up and we have sort of the flow of Cucumber to RSpec to feature going, but we don't have any features yet. So, where do you want to start, Pat?
Well, you're the customer.
Right. So, the biggest feature of Twitter is that I can write a message. So I think that we should start there.
So, and I'll just write a message and I can view my own Twitter stream, basically?
Right.
Okay.
So this would be, we're just going to do the simple microblog. So, right. So we'll start with a feature called My Twitter Stream. And so the first, you want to go with the scenario? Do you want to do in order to?
Yeah, we'll say maybe a scenario when I go in first, my Twitter stream's empty.
Right.
Right. And then after I post one thing, then I see that one thing, and then after I post two things, I should see them in the chronological order.
Reverse chronological.
You might want to repeat.
Okay, so what Pat was saying is we'll have three scenarios here. The first scenario, do you want to just type as I say the scenarios? So the first scenario is if I haven't ever tweeted before, there shouldn't be any messages. So this would be a blank stream. So we call the scenario blank stream, and so there's no given there. So when I go to
Don't I need a username? Do we need that at this point?
Count or something?
I don't think we don't even need an account yet. You think we need an account?
Okay.
There's just one user in our system.
You need a given though, right?
Okay.
We don't even need a given for this. So
can we say given an empty stream just to kind of clarify?
Yeah, we could do that. Give it an empty stream. When I view my stream.
Should I say my homepage?
Yeah, when I view my homepage, sure. We'll say that.
And I should see zero tweets.
Right. So okay. I should see zero tweets, and should it say anything? Trademark. Say what?
Nothing. I said, is that term trademarked?
Tweets? No. I don't think it is. Pat will ask. And then, do you want to do multiple scenarios here, and then we'll just work through them?
Yeah, sure. I like that.
Okay. So the next scenario is that I've tweeted once. So, and I don't think we'll even do the tweeting interface. We'll just render tweets out. So, given I have one tweet, given I have the tweet, and then... Right, and then I am very smart, it's true. When I view my homepage, then I should see BJ is so smart.
Should I say I should see one tweet?
Yeah, one tweet, and I should see BJ is so smart. And then the final scenario will say I have multiple tweets, okay. So given I, okay. Can you guys, are you guys seeing that on screen? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Given I have tweeted BJ so smart and I have tweeted, can we say in 5 minutes later I tweeted?
Sure.
Pat is also smart. Okay, that's fair. When I view my homepage, then I should see two tweets, and I should see Pat is a lot smarter, and I should see BJ is smart.
So do we care about specifying that Paddle's a lot smarter comes above, like shows higher in the stream?
Yeah.
So I what if we say, say, and I should see the following tweets in order.
That sounds good.
Tables. You can just do that, right?
Yeah. You don't need quotes and tables.
I think the word should,
oh my gosh, we're hanging out with Hash Rocket people, aren't we?
I like should.
Okay, leave.
Yeah, so, okay, the question is should, you use should, and the answer is you absolutely do not need to. You can put whatever you want in there. I know people that say that should is just duplication in them, but also it's not so much a statement of whether it should or should not do this, if that's kind of iffy, but rather it's a factual declaration. And if this fails, then, you know, or I mean, and if it doesn't do that, then it's absolutely wrong. My personal thinking on it is that if it fails, I'm going to get a test failure, so I know it's wrong. And by putting should in there, that gives me a very, you know, tiny subconscious reminder that I can always question whether it should actually do this or not. So, you know, yes, I do see the following tweets in order, but I think personally and from a business standpoint, over the next several months, I have the option of saying, well, should it actually do that or should it behave a little bit differently and can we change it? So, you know, go with whatever you like. I assume that argument did not sway anybody because it's total BS. But that's, you know, this is my personal preference, right? Right.
You have to support what you're saying. You can also, when you're writing that step information, you can very easily just not that. So you say,
mistake, and I should not see.
Right.
Something. Right.
As opposed to I don't see or I do not see or whatever.
I wasn't arguing for the sake of arguing.
The other...
Yeah, the only thing that's actually required here is the words scenario, given, and, when, and then. That's all that's actually required in a cucumber feature like this. All the other words, obviously there are some pre-generated steps that have, like, should in them. And you could say that that's a style guide. Not that you have to agree with it, but you could say that. But you don't have to have anything else in there. You don't have to have. So you don't have to have should if you don't want it.
It's my understanding, all you really need is and.
Yeah.
Given, when, and then are just,
aliases, right?
You could use all the givens. You could use all when. You could use all and if you want to. I think ands might blow up when you print it out, or it might default to given. And basically just says, look at the previous step, and when we run to output, use the same one. But as far as cucumber is concerned, given, when, and then are all aliases. They don't have any semantic meaning. It's just a communication tool, to make it read nicer. The other thing with respect to should is that sometimes on a couple projects I've used, we'll want to do things like say, given there are zero tweets in the system, and I might implement that with tweet.destroy all, right? But then I want to say, given there should be zero, then there should be zero tweets in the system, and that might be my tweet.count should equal zero, something like that. So I've got a little bit of a distinction there between my setup and my expectations, whereas if I just say, and there are, then there are zero tweets in the system, then it's ambiguous to me as to whether it should be, is that setting up any state like this first step is, or is that performing an expectation? That said, I've worked with people who don't use should at all and say, and there are zero tweets in the system, and, I like the way it looks. So, you're, like I said, it's kind of a preference thing, and if you can certainly write your cucumber features in a way that makes a lot of sense either way, I think.
Let's move on.
Okay, so we're gonna get started, eh?
A.
Do I hang out Baker and Sarah?
I know.
Okay, that's Dr. Strangelove, which we don't want. So we'll commit our feature first. So, Mr. Customer, does that look good for our Twitter stream?
It does, yes. Cool. I guess since I'm the customer, I get to go get a latte now, and you will do all the work.
Yep.
Okay.
But now you're my pair.
Oh,
now
bummer.
We're parent. Now, take off your customer hat, put on your programmer hat.
Does that look like a dunce cap? Is that the same style hat?
So my Twitter stream. We've got a whole lot in here. So, given an empty tweet stream. And
so basically, very few of the steps we just wrote have web rat steps, which means that we are going to now start by writing matching step definitions for all the given, wins, and thens that we have. And that's sort of the first... You kind of have to have those before you can even write the code. So this is...
Yeah, and the way I like to organize my step definitions is around the model that they're going to be affecting. So in this case, we're interacting with the tweet model. So I create step definitions, tweet steps. If you look on the Cucumber Wiki, it talks about organization, step organization, right? And it, because you might write like 400 different step definitions in your entire application, so you end up with a lot of stuff. So there's some information on here about how best to organize your step definitions. That said, it's still relatively flat. You basically have a whole bunch of flat step definitions. And so far, the community has not come up with a beautifully elegant way of handling that. So you don't just kind of deal with massive step definition libraries. But somebody really smart will come along and whip that into shape.
More, I usually go with the mantra of more files are better. So the more sort of contexts that you can break it into your steps into, the better. So you might, if you have, say, you know, you might have 50 or 100 steps in your user steps file. If your user does lots of things, well, you might start breaking that into the user profile steps and user, you know, what user registration steps or something like that. And the other thing is keeping them in the file in order of given when and then you kind of can start to keep them somewhat logically ordered. So.
Okay, so I ran it, so we have no model.
So we don't have a tweet model.
So we'll generate that.
Just that, right?
Right.
Just a body?
Just a body.
Cool. And do we want to put any kind of a database limit on this?
I think 140.
Okay.
I think the mic died.
Did the mic die?
Yes.
Is there no battery or what?
The battery's dead.
Well, glad we could be the guinea pigs for whoever comes up next. Quick, does anybody know the syntax for setting a limit on the string in a migration?
Limit
or max?
I think it's size, but I don't know.
You know, we'll go with size and see what happens.
Limit. Run it and see.
It's limit. Limit. Okay, just like that.
So Pat ran DB test repair right after the migrate so that it's it.
Just hold it.
Okay. So doing the DB test repair, I don't know how new some people are. But that sets up your test database to have the same schema as your dev database in all in the same rake task. You will very quickly learn that every time you run a migration, if you don't do that, you'll run your specs and they'll break and you go, "Whoa, that was just working. What's going on?" And then you realize that your schema has changed, but not your test database schema.
Hey, all right.
So that passed?
Yes. The step where we destroyed everything did, in fact, pass. Oh, you know what? So we're going to change...
It passed, but it doesn't actually test anything, so we still don't have a passing test, really.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was just that test.
What did you change it to?
Go to, so it uses paths, that RB.
Okay.
So we show them paths.
Yeah, so Cucumber has Cucumber doesn't know anything about your routes file. And it takes the approach that your routes that you probably don't want to specify your routes in your Cucumber's steps the same way you would in your routes file. You want to name them, or you want to use plain English. So you want to just say, "I go to my home page" instead of "I go to /home" or something like that. You can do /home. And it'll route to that, but that starts to get unwieldy quickly. So it has this paths file, which it automatically loads and parses. And basically, whenever you do "when I go to," whatever you put after that, it does a huge case statement on it. And when you get into a big app, this case statement gets really big, and you just start putting in human readable names for the different paths that you will have in your app. So we put in my homepage, and we just set that up as tweets path. And now Pat's generating a tweets controller. And he's going to hook up don't you want to change the route?
I don't, because we're going to my homepage, which would be after I log in.
Okay.
I guess.
Yeah, so, okay, so this is going to be, later down the road, this will be something, this will be what you go to after you log in. So we just do the resources tweets, sets up a RESTful route to the tweets controller.
So yeah, we just generated the controller, run our cucumber again. We find out that we have no index on tweets controller.
And you notice every single time we make a change, we run the cucumber thing and it tells us what the next change to do is. So first there wasn't a controller, so now we have a controller. Now it doesn't have an action, so we'll put in an action. And then probably the error will be that there's no template, so we'll put in a view. And it seems slow, but it's just kind of slow because we're narrating it, and in your daily flow, this ends up being a really good way, especially if you're ADD, like both of us are, to stay on task and always do the next thing and not get ahead of yourself and not forget where you are, and it ends up being faster.
Yeah, and just as a final thing here, we're going to see as I write my RSpec examples, I never use the word should in the description. I cannot explain that. Yes, I'm being inconsistent. Sorry.
I still use should.
So let's say tweet, that's the...
If you notice, he passed in, there's a second thing on the describe block, and that's just basically a context. So we'll have multiple describe blocks. The first thing is what you're actually describing, and the second thing that you pass in is the context you're in. You could achieve the same thing by using the context method, which is actually just an alias of describe. So we could have nested describes, one just being tweets controller and the next thing being get index. This is just sort of a shortcut for that. So he ran the specs, and there's still no index action, so now we'll go ahead and add an index action and run that. And we get an error, which is missing template for the index action, and we'll go in and add the view. We have 15 minutes left, by the way.
Okay. Next HTML ERB.
Right. We just add a blank file, don't need to put anything in it, and run the specs again. That passes.
Well, we got past the next step. I'm writing the controller specs using mocks and stubs, and that basically gets me isolation from the database, so I know that the controller works the way I expect it to, and I don't have to rely on the model behavior at this point. Cucumber is going to go through the full stack and let me know if everything's hooked up properly and if there's any problems in the integration part. But the other thing is, realistically, when you're writing these sorts of controllers that are highly RESTful, you're probably not going to need to write your own controller specs anyway, because you're going to use something like resource controller or simply resource. Inherited resources. But my question is that built into Rails 3 now?
I don't think so.
No? Okay, then we're going to do it all longhand on this one, just for the sake of example.
I almost never write controller actions.
Ta-da. They mostly come in handy when you're working on filters for your actions, and so you want to know that this set of conditions, you know, whether somebody is logged in or their role on the project or whatever, you can just write a few controller examples to cover those actions and those filters.
Well, there are generators, I think, that you didn't use a generator. I mean, you're doing everything by hand, but there are generators that will run the RSpec controller actions for you.
Totally. You can. So there are generators for the RSpec examples and stuff. I personally not a big fan of the generators, but mostly that's because, you know, when I'm not talking in a microphone and doing everything
you know, explaining everything, what we just did would take like 6 seconds to do. So, and then I only write the examples that I care about, which in this case, you know, I'm just making sure that we're calling the right method, assigning something to the view. From my perspective, those are the things that I care about the controller doing at this point. I'll rely on the framework to handle the rest of hooking up the right view, rendering it, et cetera, et cetera.
Do you want to just blaze through a little bit?
Sure.
And I'll kind of...
Okay, so we actually have two steps passing now. And we are, which is because we put in that view, and we're now to the point of actually checking that there isn't any tweets in the view. And really, we're not gonna, this is gonna be really simple to do. And our step's gonna be really basic right now because we're just gonna check that it's empty because we don't, you're actually gonna put markup in it? Here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Saying we shouldn't see any, I mean.
Right.
Well, I guess it should not do anything, right?
Yeah.
At this point, we don't care?
Right, at this point, we don't care. So, Pat, I figured Pat would start there. When we're testing that there isn't anything there, and we know there isn't anything there, writing a test to check that there isn't anything there isn't, we can never make that fail. So we just don't test for anything, and that will start failing once we actually do start putting things in, if that makes sense. So we'll actually go on to the next step now and have a tweet in the app.
One scenario is passing.
Right, because we now have one scenario passing, and we haven't actually done anything. So it's that test for if we haven't tweeted, there aren't any tweets, isn't actually testing anything yet, but it will start testing things when we get on to the next step. So we're actually going to kind of skip ahead to the next scenario and then go back once we have tweets and we can assert that there shouldn't be tweets when there aren't any tweets.
Well, I just added a step for fun.
Okay, so Pat added a step for fun.
So, and one thing is you pretty much always want to specify like that you do see something that you expect. Because one thing that I've run into a couple times, if I say I should not see this text, then if you've got the Rails error handling turned on to where it raises a 500 and it'll capture it and show you an error page, and you say then I should not see this text, if you have an error somewhere and Rails does the error handling, then obviously that text doesn't show up on the page, but then now you have, but you actually have an error there. And so you
you're still not getting what you expected.
Right, exactly. So you have you've got, you know, your test is green even though your app's broken. And there's a configuration that you can do in Cucumber to basically rescue from stuff or not. But, you know, that's just something that tripped me up. And so the basic rule is for any test, always the final step, you should be expecting to see something that you really do expect. So in this case, I said, if a user has not tweeted, then we're going to say that, hey, this user hasn't tweeted yet. Can I do an H1? Should it be a 2?
No, that's fine.
All yeah. Right.
So obviously that passes. But that's, I mean, it's we're basically just doing the simplest thing that could possibly work for this one scenario. And as we get deeper in the other scenarios, then obviously we'll have to come back and refactor that stuff. Just a side note, if you're not good with Ruby regexes and you want to do Cucumber, you're A, going to have to get pretty good with them, or at least somewhat good, and B, there's a site called rubular.com, R-U-B-U-L-A-R, and it's been around forever, and it's just a little Ajax script that you put in some text that you want to match against, and you put in the pattern that you're trying to use, so you would put in what comes after given or when or then in there, and the step that you have written, and it'll tell you if it's matching and what's matching and how many things match, and then you can it helps you get it all right. I think I spelled that right.
So just as a little note here, when I'm setting up state, I said, so I've tweeted. And in this case, like we said, we're not going through the UI to tweet something. We're just setting up the state. So when I do that, you'll notice I use create with the exclamation point here. And the whole point of that is I expect this step to pass all the time. So if for some reason, and I expect it to create a record in the database. And so if it doesn't for whatever reason, like maybe I add a validation that I need to include here later on, then I want to be alerted of that immediately. And so I want a noisy error saying, you know, couldn't create the tweet in the database. Because otherwise, if I do, you know, if I use this and it doesn't create the tweet silently, then when I go on to my next step, it's going to say, hey, I didn't see it on the screen. And now I'm going to spend a lot of time debugging, wondering like, well, okay, I'm showing everything on screen. Why is it not working? You know. So when you're doing setup stuff, you want to use the bang version of create or save so that if there's any errors, then you're alerted right away and noisily.
All right. Well, the first thing is because
we changed this. Oh, right, because we gave that first step definition a blank implementation, it's passing through. But now I want to specify that it actually has something. So I want to say, show me that there are at least two divs or spans or whatever HTML element BJ tells me is the proper one to use here. And I want to say that there are that many. And cucumber, the step definitions, because it's a regular expression, everything that gets yielded is a string. So that's one gotcha. If you are going to be comparing numbers, then whatever gets yielded to the block here, you're going to need to convert to an integer. By the way, does that step definition syntax make sense to everybody what happens here? There's a regular expression that gets matched against, I should see 5 tweets. And then when that matches that step and we get into this block, it takes that chunk of text, extracts it from the regular expression, and passes it to the block. So when I've got, I should see 1 tweet here, then whatever's matched by this first set of parentheses then gets yielded to num tweets. So in this case, I'm going to have the string 1, right? Does that make sense?
Oh, wait.
What about page that should have?
Ah, because we're using Capybara, huh?
We don't use Capybara much. We used to use WebRat.
And say, so page that should have XPath or should have, yeah, no. I use XPath, but
I hate XPath because I can't read it. But
well,
it might.
It turns it, Capybara at the end, it turns whatever your CSS is, it turns it into XPath. But we, give me a second, I'll give you an example of that. Non-XPath.
Will that work? Invalid expression. Okay, so we're getting closer.
Have content or.
Well, I want to say that
ID,
we've.
Yeah, the ID. Have CSS. Should have CSS, just straight up have much for
beautiful
CSS.
Okay. And can I pass count to that? Does you see that anywhere?
I'm looking for examples.
We might just parse it with Nokogiri, but I mean. So the API has changed between RSpec 1 and RSpec 2 and some of the matchers because they wrap Rails stuff, and so some of that has changed, so it's, you know, I forget, basically.
Old habits die hard.
Old habits die hard, right. Okay. So back to my index.
Oh, man.
So we now have the first scenario and the second scenario passing. And we're now going to go to the third scenario, which has a step, which is unusual. Just given some number of minutes later, I tweet. And has anybody used Time Cop?
Really?
Couple people? Time Cop. Yeah. You don't want to use Time Cop? How else are you going to do it?
Could you push what you've got up to GitHub?
Yeah.
We should commit.
Oh, because we got two scenarios passing.
Right.
See, we're going to show exploratory testing and why this doesn't cover everything. Because it's going to sound.
So I'm a big fan of Time Cop. It basically overrides time and lets you stop time and manipulate time in your tests. So you can say things like, you know, freeze time and then assert that 5 minutes later I do something else, and it will be 5 minutes after when you have stopped time. So if you do lots of things that end up being time sensitive, Time Cop is amazing.
I don't know if that'll work.
You could just call our other tweet, our other step. Okay.
I'm waiting for a gem to install because we didn't have it. Yes, so we're going to see if this works right now, to tell you the truth. In fact, let's just test something real quick and say I should see 3 tweets. All right, cool. So we see here that in this case, when I specified the count was 0, it knows that I shouldn't see any of them. So, you know, it wasn't looking for that one. And then if I specify 3 tweets where there's only 1, I expect that this will say, you know, yeah, it should have this. That that error message isn't particularly helpful because it's not saying expected to find 3 of them and only got 1. But, you know, hey, it fails. And it's open source, so go ahead and commit a fix to make it friendlier.
If you guys could do that while we're up here, and then that'd be great.
You could also use paste.all and then give it the expat that you don't like dot size.
Yeah.
And then, you know, do whatever.
Right, you can
give you expected 3 to come out of it, but whatever.
You can do some kind of cool stuff, like Pat Nakajima has a project for kind of parsing out the HTML in tests. And so you could basically say something like this, where you go like, you know, tweets is you know, Naka project. So it looks sort of like Nokogiri. And then you say, actually, you know what? You could just very easily do this with Nokogiri and say tweets is Nokogiri page.body divided by, you know, dot tweet. And then using RSpec, you say tweets dot should have num tweets items. And that way you're saying, okay, so we've got the list of tweets and it should have 3 items. So let's see what happens if I do this just for fun. And I want to change that to 3, right? Out of time. Yeah, so in this case, expected 0 items got 0. So,
that didn't work.
See, there we go. There's that whole thing with strings and numbers. Right, so expected 3 items got 1. So you can do stuff like, if I've got, you know, if this is failing for, if I get a failure and it doesn't give me much information, then I like to add a different expectation that will give me some info.
Yeah.
So can we write this next step in the definition in 2 minutes? Probably not.
No. You want to try it?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay.
Let's do it. Okay, we'll probably go 2 minutes over. So we're going to blaze through this without much explanation because we kind of have to.
I'll try to follow along.
Right. So I'm going to keep... Yeah, you know what? Let's do
just
that.
Just keep that.
Let's just do it like that.
Right.
I like it.
So we still have this one step, and it uses a cucumber table, which are pretty cool. Little ASCII, you can put in an ASCII table, and it'll grab the header row and turn that into the hash name, basically, the variable that comes in. And this is basic; it just basically comes in as a big hash for you.
It's an array of hashes. So in fact, let's look at that real quick. We'll say ptable dot, well, ptable. Actually, that's going to be some cucumber object. So we can say table values, and we'll see. It's not values.
No.
Is it entries?
Yeah.
Undefined method, each for cucumber AST table. Well, that's hideous.
I don't know what that is.
Student inspect.
Table.rows hash.
Thank
rows
you.
Underscore hash.
Right.
Actually, I think we can just do rows. Because I don't want a hash. I want the
right.
array.
Yes.
I want the array of hashes, right? So you're totally right. Rows hash?
Yeah.
Right.
I know what I was looking for. It's table hashes is what I'm personally trying to get in this one. Right,
there.
So there we go. There's that array of hashes that I'm looking for. So now once I've done that, we're going to do something that's sort of an ugly kind of step definition to basically let me say this one comes before this one comes before this one. And in this case, what I'm going to do is get the list of tweets like we did before using Nokogiri, and then I'm going to get the IDs in the array and make sure that those show up the way that I expect them to. And make sure that those match up with the... ID, you know, the order from this. Actually, we don't have to do that in this case. We can just collect the content of the tweets and compare them against that. Right, so. Can I do this?
So that should return an array of the actual body of the tweets. And now we're grabbing what's in our plain text table.
I don't know if we can do this, but... Right, because
it should just
tweets.
Be tweets.
Undefined method tweet because I can't do it like that. I have to say map tt tweet.
All right, so we see in this case that they are reversed. They're not the order that we want them to be in. So I am just going to go into tweet. Can you do a default scope?
Yeah. We're just adding a default scope so that they come in, like on Twitter, in reverse chronological order. And they pass. So now we can tweet, and they come out in the right order. And if we haven't tweeted, there's a message for that.
Yep, and next session we will start off with a little bit of exploratory testing because... As we'll see, there's just a little UI problem right now besides it looking completely ugly. But we'll start off with a little exploratory testing session to see, you know, catch any problems that our TDD process didn't catch. And then we'll move on with doing users and following users.
Right. Questions about this at this point as we went through? Anything look weird or really bad or good or what? right.
Okay. Ooh, that was loud. Twitter 2.0, Code Immersion, round 3. Is everybody ready to rumble? All right, so I'm gonna pass it over back to BJ. But in this session, we're, like I said, if we verify that we got through our first set of cucumber scenarios, which was my very basic, when I tweet, it shows up. We see those run, so now we would say, like, okay, this feature is ready to deliver to our customer. But before we do that, we want to do a little bit of exploratory testing, hammer the application a little bit, which is gonna take us 5 minutes because it's, you know, it's a stupid application, but it's a stupid simple application too, so it's not gonna take any time to test, but we'll do that, write any tests for problems that we find, and then move on with the whole next set of features. Cool? Cool.
So, Mr. Customer, let's look at...
If you'll notice, this is the first time we've actually booted a web server. So it tends to go a lot faster, development does. Yay!
Ta-da! This user has not tweeted yet.
It goes a lot faster if you're not constantly like writing code and then going to your web server and hitting refresh every time. If you have tests, you don't have to do that. It's pretty amazing. You might notice that we don't actually have a UI for creating tweets yet. So we're going to create one via the console. And now if we go to the web browser, hey, it says we have not tweeted yet. That's a problem. We have tweeted. We've tweeted twice. Two tweets.
Those tweets. So we've basically...
You know, I would check this in the browser before handing it off to the tester, but you know, you also, like, if you've got testers on the team who, their role's not really just to find little bugs or like run through scripts, because if they have a script to follow, then you're wasting a person's time and frankly their life, because nobody likes following a script. You know, that's not a good existence. So when they do find bugs and like automated, or when they have scripted checks, then you wanna write automated tests for that. So, in this case, you know, we see that there is a bug here that it's telling us the user has not tweeted yet, when in fact we have. So at this point, we would write or modify a new test, to catch this problem, and then use that to test drive our solution. So in this case, I'm very simply going to modify one of the features. And so after I say I have tweeted once, after that I don't really care, and I should not see this user has not tweeted yet. That was my server, huh? That's my console. So. All right, so we see that one failed. So we've got our automated test in place that checks that same bug that we found from exploratory testing. Go ahead and change our code to make it work. So. Ta-da, passing, and by the powers of Rails, we have no need to restart the server, and we refresh, and there we go, right? So if we go back into our console, delete everything, we see exactly what we expect, that the user has not tweeted yet. And like BJ said, you know, we were able to make progress on this, like a whole Twitter list and some business logic, without ever once looking at the browser. So the whole original Java model was write code, you know, start up your app server, find a bug, take down your app server, change it, change the code, start the app server again, blah, 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 really, really slow. Rails sped that up a lot by saying you don't have to restart the app server, you can just kind of change code on the fly, but then test-driven development brings that even tighter. So you'll notice what we're doing is we're getting feedback loops here, that as soon as we make a change, like once we make a change, how quickly do we get feedback as to whether that change is good or bad or did it break anything? And so one of the things that we're trying to do is get very, very tight feedback loops. And so that's one reason, you know, you'll see that like we used AutoTest, right? And AutoTest automatically runs everything for us as soon as we change a file, and then we used Growl to tell us the auto test results. So basically, as soon as I save a file, I know within a few seconds whether you know my changes were good or bad, or the next steps that I need to take.
So that concludes our exploratory testing session. Unless there's other stuff you want to look for.
No. Well, I did notice that we don't have any times on tweets. I think it'd be really nice, like. We might get really good ROI if we had times.
Okay.
Isn't that what the customer always says? I don't know.
We'll have good ROI. So how does that rank in priority to other stuff that we want to do?
Okay, we can go on.
I'm just asking, customer. I say let's do that later, and let's do following users.
Okay, well, let's do users first. Let's actually have a user. And then we can follow them.
You know, and I'm going to start committing and pushing more frequently so that if you get like 5 minutes behind and you want to catch up, then it'll be easier to do.
All right, so now we need a feature for
following a user.
Well, we need users first, right?
We don't. I mean, we need to write the feature that drives out the... Okay, so, you know, it'd be natural to say, okay, at this point, we need a user model, but we're going to write a feature that drives that first and says we, you know, like, it turns out that we can get the notion of a Twitter stream, a very basic generic Twitter stream, without having to write any users. As soon as we get into following users, we anticipate that we will need users. But hey, maybe we can always just attach a username to a tweet right now, and we don't actually care about the. We'll see. That's kind of the point, right? The design is incremental and iterative, and so we make improvements to it as we see fit. But instead of, you know, we might do some brainstorming to say, okay, well, we'll probably end up with the user model, and the relationships might look like this. But we don't want to commit to anything until our tests. Show it, kind of guide what we do. And that's the whole part of the driven part of test-driven design or test-driven development.
I think the first feature is going to be looking at someone else's tweets. So let's do that first.
So this is going to look, I assume it'll look similar to the one that we had done before, but instead, in this case, we'll specify a user and then view their stream instead.
Yeah, I think that we might say that there might be a scenario if the user does not exist, if we don't have any tweets from that user, they probably don't exist yet, and then... Why are you working on those?
I'm not. I'm copying and pasting.
Copying and pasting. Well, I think the blank stream is given. Given I have zero tweets. Right?
Cool. So given BJ...
Should it say the user has not tweeted yet or there is no user?
Well, does BJ exist at this point or not?
Well, not if he hasn't tweeted. Unless he hasn't signed up.
We'll do a different scenario for somebody else.
Okay.
When I go to...
So in this case, we're just writing two scenarios, and it looks pretty much the same. But basically, we're going to be going to a different URL, so a different, slightly different action, different controller. There's going to be some stuff different to it. And I guess we also want to, do we want to say that when I visit my Twitter stream, that his information shows up, but maybe with the username that did it?
Well, I think we say that when we view...
We haven't followed a user yet.
Right.
We have no notion of follows.
Right.
What about a background that sets up all this stuff, right? That you say, hey, given I am BJ and I'm following such and such. And then that sets it up for everybody.
Yeah, totally. We will get, when we do following, we will, you know, we'll use a background there. I think at this point, you know, we're looking at more or less the same thing, which is just saying I can view a user's page. And honestly, like, I don't know that I care about even the blank stream. We just want to know that I can view their page and I see the tweets that they made.
Right.
And maybe it doesn't show tweets that I made.
Right, exactly. Right. The other thing is you just put this in the wrong feature file. Yeah, you're in the manage view home pages one.
Okay, maybe I did.
View other users at the bottom. No, it is.
Scenario shows that user's tweets, but not mine. Right?
Right.
Given I have tweeted this tweet, and BJ, and I should not see this tweet.
So as you can see, sometimes it takes a little bit of refactoring on your cucumber stories to get the right story that sets up the right scenario that you want to test. It's not always as simple as just writing out a bunch of plain text, which is sort of, this ends up being what people say is the bad thing about cucumber, that you can't just turn this over to non-technical people because they won't know how to set up the right state to test and to drive out the particular feature that they want.
With that said, the idea that you will have a business person or a non-technical end user write your acceptance test for you is a total pipe dream, and it's probably more of a nightmare than it is a dream, so don't even try with that. My preferred structure for writing these tests, like, you always want a pair on everything, including acceptance test writing. And so I like to do one of two things. Ideally, I can get a developer, a tester, and the customer or product designer or user experience person together and have them tricing, I don't know, whatever three people pairing is, and just have them work together, because then you get good knowledge transfer among those three people, and they're going to be looking at it from different points of view. Other than that, you know, if you can get the product owner and the developer pairing, or maybe you have a conversation between the product owner, the tester, and the developer, and then the tester and developer go off and pair. Usually, testers have a better idea of what the product owner wants than developers do, because we just kind of like to write the code that we want to write. And so, you know, I don't know. Most of the time you're like, well, the customer doesn't actually know what's going to be good for this. But for some reason, testers are more empathetic, I guess. And so they develop a really good understanding of the customer's expectations. And so you want them involved in the testing process. One thing you don't want to do is just write your acceptance test independently of everybody else and then email it to them and have them look at it.
that is roughly 20% as useful as actually pairing with them. If that, because what happens is they check their email in between going to meetings and they say, yeah, that looks good. And then when you actually demo it to them, they're like, what the heck? This is not what I asked for at all. So you want to establish an actual communication between them, a face-to-face interaction with them, high fidelity interaction when you do this, so that you don't, you know, you avoid some of those problems.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Any suggestions for getting them to do that? I found that sometimes they don't seem to be interested in doing that.
Okay, so question is, how do you actually get people to do this when they're not interested? And there are innumerable strategies for doing this, I guess. But one of my favorite things when introducing any technique or new bit of process is saying, let's try it for a week or let's try it for 2 weeks. Basically saying, like, I'm asking for an honest commitment from them for a very short window of time. And if it doesn't work, then, you know, like, we haven't committed to anything. It's just a little experiment. We'll see what happens. And if we like what we did, we move on with it. If we don't like it, then, you know, we just ignore it and forget it ever happened. So that's one good thing. I have also, when I've been team lead on stuff, I've said that nobody writes code until we've got the acceptance test in place. And at first it was just kind of like, well, you know, how are we actually going to get anything done? And believe me, when you tell your project manager or your product designer that you are not going to write any code, like, I'm just going to fix bugs and refactor and do whatever I want until you make the time to tell me what you want and express it in a way that is useful to both of us, somehow they figure out how to make the time. So that takes, you know, you need one person on the team to have the balls to stand up to whoever else, you know, is not going to go along with this. Dave, you have some suggestions?
Yeah, so I just wanted to share my experience. I've done this 3 times now, and all 3 times I went into it with that exact same trepidation of, these guys, I'm going to waste their time, they're not going to want to hear this, da 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 da. All 3 times I have kind of spun it, you know, benefits, not features, and you start saying, can I get you to just come sit with me for a minute and look at for a way to kind of express these acceptance tests? And you start writing this little text document that says, given this, then this, and then this. And they go, yeah, okay, yeah, I've kind of got the rhythm of this. And then I say, oh, by the way, this is executable code. And they go, bullshit. And then you write the steps and run it, and they go, holy shit. And then it's an easy sale after that. All 3 times, I've had complete buy-in just by demoing it to let them see it.
Do you use story card with that?
I have never mastered story cards, I'll confess that. We're trying them now at work, but we're not doing them well.
Because that's the eye-opener for the client. Like, when they go through that 2 or 3 days of story carding and they, you know, do all these features out in stories, and they're like, wow, I didn't even know that I was thinking about it. And then you extract what's up out of their mind, and they see it, and it will track them. Mm-hmm. And then that's their acceptance. There's a lot of tools that you can use, Tempo Pro Pickler, which will bring the story from Google Tracker into a feature, and then it'll show it at the top of your feature. It'll say, you know, where it's going to, and then you can close it or whatever. But that's been, you know, the main point. When the client goes through that process of storyboarding, then they're totally bought in, because by that point they've seen a demo of, you know, integration test, and they see the, you know, selecting test with the browser popping up, and that's like the wow factor for them to see that stuff. So that's been my experience.
Yeah, you know, another thing is, instead of trying to say, hey, will you write acceptance tests with me, you say, can you give me some examples? Because people understand examples very well and communicate in examples. And so you can basically say, look, every time that you tell me what to do, I forget what it is, and then we go through this whole round of back and forth where we're trying to figure out what to build, and, you know, maybe like a week later we figure out that it was wrong. So if you spend 10 minutes with me to go over some examples. I'm going to write them down just so we're so I'm clear on what it is that you're expecting of this. Then, you know, and then it goes to exactly what Dave said. You've captured examples. They look at it. They say, yeah, okay, that's exactly what I meant. And then you run it against the code, and that's kind of the epiphany. And it goes really, really fast once you get into it. And I mean, it takes like a week of training them and like training by osmosis to get your business people really up to speed with this, to the point where, you know, we had done this for like 2 or 3 weeks, and I could sit down with our product owner, and before lunch on Monday, we would have all of our acceptance tests for the entire week's iteration done. So we're able to crank through those examples really, really quickly. Yeah.
I'm just gonna point out that in the same vein, every PM I've ever worked with is frustrated that the stupid developers on his team can't get it through their thick skulls to build the software the way his grand vision is. And yeah, when they, this trepidation that we have of getting them to pair with us on Cucumber, it really is, it's a false fear. As soon as they see that they can get what they want with it, they will push it.
Yeah, and the important thing is that you're opening up a communication channel that probably isn't really there before. And one of the things that I find with any of the agile practices and stuff is once you get going with it hardcore, a lot of the resistance is because the organization is so messed up that, you know, like everybody realizes all of a sudden that they don't have a clue what's going on, and the communication channels between the teams are no good, and yada, yada, yada. And so like you do test-driven development and you find out that the whole organization is a mess. And yeah, that's a really, really scary thing, but it gives you, you know, a starting point to fix stuff. So enough soapboxing, time to code.
Right. Let's write some code.
Okay, so I think we'll get a user model.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we probably need a user model too.
Can I do that?
I don't think you need to.
Well, kinda.
Yes. Okay, try it. One of the interesting things about Cucumber step definitions I found is that sometimes you end up defining what you want sort of the API to look like or how you're interacting with things to look like in your step definition, and then you have to go back and figure out how to actually make it work. So we don't have a user, they don't have names yet, and they don't have tweets yet, but this is how we kind of want to create some tweets, is by finding or creating a user by their name and then creating a tweet off that. And so now we have an idea of what the next sort of, what we want the code to look like in the end or be able to do. And this is kind of a boring example, but as you get into it, you get more examples of that.
It's a very exciting example, and you guys are all very, very, very happy to be here, is what he meant to say.
Sure. If you notice, because we made the app aware of RSpec, we no longer get test unit tests when we generate models. That's nice. Rails 3, yay, finally. So many deleted tests until Rails 3. Test unit test files.
Okay, so we migrated, we prepared Cucumber that action.
So we run the Cucumber again, and we get kind of the bang doesn't work. So we see that there's no tweets. Users don't know about tweets. Obviously, we haven't edited the user file yet. Put in one line. Run the Cucumber feature again. Tweets don't have user IDs. We'll add a migration for that. If we got an email here and we had to respond, So it distracted us. We could come back and the error message is right there. We know exactly what we were doing.
Not that I any project manager would ever interrupt programmers when they're working. Really? You guys must work in better companies than I do.
We migrate. Now we should have a different message.
Okay.
So now we get that there's no mapping here. This is the paths issue, paths.rb. So we have to set up a new win, basically.
Is that right for non-white space or string stuff, I guess?
Take out that first quote and escape the apostrophe. Think.
Okay. So now we want to say user is.
So the nice thing about this paths file is that in your case, it's a Ruby file and you can do Ruby. So now we can just find the Ruby, the user using what we just matched out of that path, and then return the route that we want. I don't think Pat thinks we're going to match here. Now we get an undefined method user tweets path, and that's because we don't have a route. So we go to routes, we hook this up.
Let's see, I want to say namespace, right?
I don't know Rails 3 routes very well. Can't you just do routes? Users do.
Well, we don't have a users controller.
Or resources users? Oh, that's right. Yeah, so do namespace.
So, but is that going to have the user ID?
No.
Let's just do this. Let's say match users / name.
Right.
Tweets.
Don't you want that ID? Oh, no, you want a name.
I want it to be a name.
So we're just doing a real basic path here, because we don't have a user's controller yet. We can't do, if we had a user's controller, we could just say resources users do, and then resources tweets inside of there, and it would make the nested route that we want. But we don't want to do the user's controller yet. We don't need that. So we'll do the simplest thing that'll work here, which is just matching a basic route. And I think we have to give that a name of some kind, don't we? Oh, he did. I missed that. I was talking. We can run this. We should get a routing error.
No route matches controller tweets.
Still wants a controller.
Why not? Huh? No, it's saying it's going to the tweets. Wait, we didn't have a tweets controller. No, yeah, we do. It's on the red. Why doesn't it like that? No, it doesn't need to go. No route matches. Oh, I bet that's not.
Oh, you've got name in the controllers field, I think.
Yeah, you know, I bet that's not taking the I bet that's not taking the user in there. So we're going to just kind of go through this really quickly and create a users controller if we need to, so that we can do the nested routes. No route matches controller tweets action create. How do we get to that?
I don't know. Huh. Line 19 in paths is what it said.
Yeah.
Why make it nested?
Sorry, what was that?
Why make it a nested route? Just make it a regular route.
Well, I actually, wait, we want to say tweet / and the user.
Okay.
That would make more sense, right?
No.
Yeah, let's no, let's do that. Trust me.
Or a member action. Oh, yes. And that collection.
Right.
Yeah, so I'm going to change this to say tweets to Paz, and now I'm going to say tweet path user dot name. And so that's basically, we're going to go to slash tweet slash the user.
Why don't we just, we don't need the find now.
Huh?
We don't need the find.
Oh, you're right. Totally. Not that that's readable, but. Okay, so the action show cannot be found, so that's pretty good. If we go to our tweets controller, you know, now I would probably want to, I want to write my controller specs for this. So I'm going to say describe tweets controller get show.
And keep in mind, we're not following REST to a T here. I am sort of glossing over the fact that there are things that I don't know about Rails 3 routing and don't feel like figuring out 100% entirely in this session.
He promises to look it up tonight and tell you all the right way to do it tomorrow.
Tweets. okay, so we'll say user dot stat. Let's say this. Tweet dot stat.
So this is the other place where you will sort of figure out what your, what you want the code to look like, what code you're going to use, is when you're writing your specs, usually controller specs, you're deciding what methods on models you're going to call and things like that. And this is sort of where the design starts to come out that comes with doing BDD. A lot of people like to say that RSpec is a really good design tool. And it's this type of stuff that I think they're talking about usually. So basically, Pat's setting up a stub user. And a stub is, if you're not familiar, basically just a dumb object. It doesn't know anything. It doesn't know that it's a user. It doesn't know that there's a table there. It doesn't know that it has any fields. It's not going to respond to much of anything more than what object would respond to. And if you look at line 15, where we say user stub tweets, we're adding, oh, he's as he changes it as I speak, by adding that hash into the stub method there, he's just saying, if Ruby sends me a message called tweets, this is what I'm going to return. It doesn't know if that's a variable, it doesn't know if that's a method, it doesn't know anything other than if you pass me this message called tweets, I'm going to spit out this stuff back to you. And so by using this stub, we're not going to hit the database. We don't even need a database there. It's going to be fast, and there are sort of bad things that could happen, such as if we remove the tweets method, this spec wouldn't break, but our app might break. But hopefully, we would have other specs that would catch that, too.
What's the difference between the stub and a double?
In RSpec 2, absolutely nothing. They're aliases for each other. So there's a whole bunch of different terminology when it comes to using fake objects in testing. You'll hear mock stubs and doubles, and there are endless mailing list debates over what terminology to use where. What I'm going to use for these sessions when we use stuff is we're actually just going to talk about stubbed methods and expected methods. So when we do should receive, that means that the test will fail if that particular object does not receive that method at some point during the test run. So if we look at in my tweets controller spec where I said user should receive find with BJ, that's saying that when I run that test, user must receive that message and it should have that one argument. If it receives find, or if it never receives find, or it receives it with a different argument, then that test is actually going to fail. Whereas if we just said stub, then it doesn't care. So it's basically whether the object automatically verifies the message calls that it got or not. In terms of the actual terminology, practically you can be relaxed with it because it doesn't actually have an effect on anything. And the terminology at this point is so muddled that I wouldn't bother trying to be strict.
I usually mock objects and stub methods just out of habit, and I don't even know where I got that, but so I would have changed line 13 to say mock. But it really doesn't matter.
Which happens to be an alias in RSpec, so it right. really, really doesn't matter.
Did you run those tests?
Huh? Oh, yeah, and you know what? And we're gonna...
So I already noticed an error here, but we're gonna find out what happens when you kind of the disconnect between mocking and stubbing and the actual application. So we'll see how we get this test to pass, and then when we run Cucumber, it's going to fail horribly, miserably.
Which is why we write both tests.
All right, so that's passing.
Next up, I don't want to just copy the show page over to index, so we're going to say that when I actually get this, instead of trying to render show, it's going to render our the index template for us. Okay, we'll see something here. It's actually doing a find, so we didn't stub out find in this particular example. And so now it's flowing through to the active record behavior of looking up a record with that ID, which obviously doesn't exist. So this is where we start setting stuff up. And in fact, then there's also some helper methods to define particular objects that you can use in your tests. So I'm going to do that and also do a before to stub the user thing. So just showing that.
If you've been using RSpec for a while, the let syntax is sort of replacing before blocks, before each blocks, so that you don't have to set up instance variables. You're setting up local variables and they get cleared and you get less problems with shared state between examples.
Also, it used to be lazy, you don't have to do that anymore. Do let bam. Let bam, baby. There you go. Now you don't have to do that. Oh, explicitly.
Okay, yeah, so...
Well, you still have to do it before loop for whatever you were going to do, but not call user there.
Right. So when you call let, it's lazy initialized. So as soon as I call user, that's when it comes into existence. So that means if you're setting up any database state and you haven't called the method, the helper method, to define that that fixture for you, basically, then it won't be created and you'll get a weird test failure. Whereas I'm guessing, because this is brand new to me, that let bang initializes it right then upon test run, so it's not lazily initialized.
I'm still working on RSpec on Rails 2 stuff, but then I know that this exists, so I'm like, I wish this existed in RSpec 1.x.
Oh, it doesn't? Oh, yeah, and David's been very much like, no changes to RSpec 1 because, it's like, development's done, so... Right. If you want stuff like this, it's kind of going to have to be in your branch. Although we are working on getting RSpec 2 working on Rails 2, but that is still in the works.
But RSpec 2 does work on Rails 3?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. It works only with Rails 3 in terms of Rails.
Did they release it from beta?
Huh?
Did they release it from beta?
No.
No.
Okay, so it still has the beta tag on
it. Yes.
Yeah, we're using 2.0.0.beta.19 right now.
And there's actually a newer one, but it had a problem with WebRat that I didn't want to deal with in here, but it turns out we're not using WebRat anyway, so it was avoided. But yeah. Okay, so if you look at what's going on, well, let's see. We should get past that one error. Right, expecting index, but it got rendered with tweets show. So now I go into my tweets controller, and I want to say render action is index instead of show. Cool. So that way, when I go to a particular user's Twitter stream, then I'm actually using that same file that I was using before. So if we look at the test that we just wrote, we did a little bit of a refactoring here because we would have to set up the user twice. We would have to stub the user twice. So we said, OK, let's just define it once using let, and then stub it out in a before. And if you look on line 19, when we do the expectation, saying that it should receive find with BJ, then that basically overrides the stub that existed before. So you can initially stub it, but then constrain the method call further if you want.
One thing, in this case, you don't necessarily need the let back, right?
Correct.
Because you're calling it that before.
Right.
And the other thing, I remember there was some sort of rule floating around somewhere that if you have a should receive in one example, that you should stub it anywhere else. And the should receive has precedence over the stub. And
right.
I guess it's a stub that you just explained.
Right. Right.
Yeah, usually what I do is I stub things out in my before block or in let or whatever, and then I'll have one test that has a should receive in there that tests out whatever I'm stubbing. So I know that each thing I've stubbed out is actually going to get called the way I expect it to be called, and then I don't care in other places.
But you know, you'll notice that like on line 5, you know, I said that when we want to expect a call, then you should receive, but some, like if you look at line 5 and line 7, there is no way at all that assigns tweets would ever equal that hash or would ever equal that array of symbols unless you went through the method that I stubbed, right? So I know implicitly that yes, I didn't set an explicit method expectation. But the fact that I got back the data that I wanted means that I know that I hit the part that I wanted to. So I can write a looser test expectation. Like, I don't care, you know, what was called or how many times it was called. I know implicitly that I hit the method that I set up because there's no other way to get that data anyway.
Right. We could write another test that has the should receive, but it doesn't. It wouldn't be testing anything new.
So now we run cucumber and get, oh, couldn't find user with ID BJ. So we realize we've got a little problem here, which is that we're using find, which looks up by the ID, when we actually want to look up by the name. So we found that our unit test was not perfect in the sense that like the subs and mocks are disconnected from the actual underlying objects. And what we're trying to do is just design the controller. Basically, we're saying like we find the user, then we get their tweets, assign that to the view, and render this particular template. So I don't care that the rest of the stuff works, but I do need a test in place that lets me know, you know, if there are any integration problems. And so that's where cucumber comes in really nicely. So I would start off saying, okay, this needs to be this needs to be by the name. So I'll say user stub find by name, and we'll do a similar thing.
Name.
Yeah, I do. Because you know, if we do find by name and it returns, and that user doesn't exist, then it'll raise an active record not found, which Rails will automatically do a 404 for you. So it's kind of nice. So we look at this. It says couldn't find that user. That means we're going through the model that we didn't want before. Change that out. Run cucumber. We should be good. I hope. Oh no.
Did we create a user?
I thought we did. Oh, couldn't find user with name as BJ. How about that? So in view other users, Twitter stream. And BJ has tweeted.
Is it a case problem?
Is it a case problem? Well, let's see. We had lowercase BJ. We've got lowercase BJ. So that shouldn't be a problem. What are we getting here? Oh yeah, and Cucumber has like the failure output. So I can actually run just that one particular scenario by copying and pasting the line that it gives me. Right, so I've got user with an ID of name.
That's weird.
ID of one, his name is BJ.
It says it's in line 7 of Tweets Controller.
Tweets Controller RB Show.
Oh, are you... What are you creating?
Isn't it Pram's name?
Yeah, wouldn't it be Pram's name?
No, we're getting the right Pram.
Yeah.
No, we created the user before we set anything up. We said, so he's tweeted it, then I go to his Twitter stream. So honestly... I don't know.
Do you want to stop here?
No, because we're almost done. So now I want to do this. So now we're going into stupid print debug mode. So look, we have... So he exists with that name. So what's our... Maybe our params ID is over there. Oh, you know what? I know what the problem is. Or no, I don't have any idea what the problem is.
Ben, get rid of the Ben.
Yeah, but then we're just going to get nil, right?
Shouldn't it be params colon name?
No, because we're passing it the ID, because this is using like the Rails RESTful stuff.
Okay.
Right, so now we're getting nil here. That's why I wanted to do a bang here. So, I don't know, p params. Look at that. Okay, so we're getting, so it says with name is BJ, and that BJ actually includes the quotation marks. So if I go into paz and I say, right, because we wrap this in quotes, right? All right, cool. So now, should be, if we go to tweets BJ, this will fail because the user doesn't exist, which is what I want. Now I'll do Rails console, will create a user. All right, see, he hasn't tweeted yet. So user tweets create audit equals, this is BJ's first tweet. And hey, there we go. So now I can view my tweets by going to slash... Actually, wait, no, we can't because we said it's tweets.all. So this would be now that we've introduced users, we're going to have to start to
refactor.
Kind of... We're going to have to refactor and you know, filter out some stuff in our homepage. But at least now we've introduced a new user there, and we are using the same, you know, the same view logic, but now filtering it based on the user. So...
Before we stop, can we get some feedback? Are we going too fast, too slow, too high level, too low level? Anything?
All right, everybody, good morning. And welcome to this fourth and final session of our code immersion. We will be adding the last blisteringly amazing features of Twitter version 2.0. I believe we will be adding the ability to follow users today. So. Once you follow certain users, their tweets will show up in your homepage. Does that sound right, Mr. Customer?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
What's buggy today?
We're going to try to go a little bit faster and not get off on tangents as we've done.
Right. We will code for the first 15 minutes or 20 or 30, get it all out of the way, and then all the tangents can... start then once we get follows working. But if we have no follows, we have no business model.
or and something.
And nothing to scale. Okay. So features. Followers. Users. Shows.
So on this feature, we're going to set up some background, which are steps that we'll run before we run every scenario. This is usually used for things like authentication, or, you know, if you're, you know, say your app has the concept of projects and everything happens within inside a project, you might set up just a project in here and get that out of the way and then go on to actually do scenarios inside of whatever that context is.
Are backgrounds new in 2.0 or then also in 1?
This is Cucumber, not RSpec, and this has been in Cucumber for a long time.
So now that background will apply to every scenario.
Yes, exactly. Right. It's like a setup in XUnit or before in RSpec.
And if you're not careful, your background steps will slow down your test suite, because if you set up a lot of data, it'll really, really slow down things because it runs every single scenario in this feature or whatever.
Oh, P.S., all the code that we did yesterday, we committed and pushed out to GitHub. So, you know, if you haven't seen it, or I mean, if you don't have the code yet, you can pull and be up to date.
What? We don't really have a concept of logged in yet. So we have to write this step first. This implies we'll probably have to do some kind of authentication type thing. I don't think we won't go into doing full authentication. We'll just have some sort of fake thing set up.
Can we access the session right in here?
No, do cookies.
Cookies?
Yeah, it's easier.
Would anyone else like to pair? Anybody? I've been up here the whole time.
Are you saying you're tired of them
fast? Yeah, I get tired of them fast. You want to do it, Ro?
Sure, why not?
Come on.
I just tweeted a picture of you and him, but I don't want to be like you.
What's up? All right. So where were we?
So we had just run. We just set up a step that says I'm logged in as whoever, and so by doing that we created the user, and then put that user's name in the session, well, in cookies, so that we can look them up and go to our homepage. Then next step we're just going to be setting up follows, saying that BJ follows Pat. And then that Pat's tweet show up on BJ's homepage.
Do you want to narrate or code?
I'll narrate.
Okay.
So Right now we're watching Pat type.
Thanks.
Cool. So as you can see, you know, this is just regular expression stuff. And then are we gonna introduce the factories?
Yes, let's do that now.
All right. Factory girl. Oh wait,
we
you're right.
We already have fixture.
Fixture.
We already have fixture.
Sorry. Oh, no worries. And this gives you an easy way of creating stuff. It's a very technical term. Because it's so simple. Because
we only have one attribute for everything. Yeah. So I don't even care about that.
So never mind. Right. So.
Follower.
Yeah. Follower dot. We don't have that association, do we?
Follow three. Follow the name. Mm-hmm. We'll say follow.
Oh, I missed that part.
Well, we haven't done it yet.
Oh, go for it. Let it break.
All right.
Cool. Do you write unit tests at the model level? Just to, you know, for instance, in this, you know, association, ensure that both exist and stuff like that.
I don't typically write unit tests for associations unless I'm putting some kind of criteria on them, because they get tested implicitly through everything else. So, you know, I know that if I can create a follower and I'm able to, in the view somewhere, I say, you know, look up the tweets through the followers, then that's good enough for me. I've got test coverage there somewhere. I just assume that Rails works. So I can say, you know, has many followers, has many tweets through followers, and or through, yeah, through followees, I guess, at that point.
Right.
So I don't worry about it until I put some kind of conditions on it or constraints, you know. Like I say that there's a limit to the number of followers or they're ordered in a certain way, then I would start to test it.
Cool.
Well, we'd love to see that.
Huh?
We'd love to see that.
Well, I mean, it can be as easy as just bringing in pseudo macros, and you can just throw in a couple of
Yeah.
You know, it should belong to follower, it should belong to followee. And then it'll ensure that those two lines of code are in there, lines 2 and 3.
How about this? We will do a unit test to validate uniqueness of follows, saying that, you know, you can't follow the same person twice, obviously, right? You shouldn't be able to do that. You don't want their...
Or follow yourself.
Or follow yourself, right? So we'll get a couple of those unit tests in there.
Let's. Do you have rake cucumber, or you just run one by one? Rake cucumber will be test prepare as well.
Cool. An initialized constant, follower or followee. Last
name. Czar. All right. Let's just make that pass.
So apparently, I have tweeted, so these should not be single quotes.
I would have been done by now and Vim, by the way. Just to make that clear.
Okay, cool.
All right, so now.
So actually, now what we want to do is we've got, since we've got our follow relationship set up, we haven't set up any notion of followed tweets. So that's what we're going to want to do is just do a basic unit test right now that says any any tweets that from somebody that I follow show, you know, I've got access to those.
I was gonna say, what about instead of doing that, instead of how about doing this? What do you think of that? So we will have a describe, and then another describe that describes a method. Like that, without the topic. It's, you know, it's a stylistic thing.
You'll notice I was already done with that in TextMate.
Yeah, I know, it's because TextMate is silly.
So if you haven't, if you're not familiar with RSpec's nested describes, we're using a nested describe here. And it's actually kind of nice because if you set up anything in the outside describe, like if you do any sort of context or setup in there, or befores or lets or anything like that, then those cascade down to the nested describes as well. So you can, I typically use these a lot in controller examples where I will say, I'll set up some basic context and then I'll say, I'll have one nested describe for a successful request and one for a failed request and then any other conditions I deal with.
Here, use that. You're more efficient. And one thing to note is what I try to do, and there's nothing special about context and describe, but what I, as a general rule I follow is, we describe methods, and then we, in the context is English, you know, so if you're trying to describe something, not describe, if you're trying to, you know, show something, you use context. So context, some English phrase, but you're describing a method. So if it would be, this is an instance method, but if it was a class method, it would be describe dot whatever, right? So. Just a convention that we use to identify stuff when you're looking at tests. So. So subject dot follow tweets should.
Need to follow, right? So follow.
Oh, this is the follow. Sorry, yeah.
Other user.
Yep.
So subject dot follow tweets
should not include, or should include, yeah. And then other. Wait.
Cool.
But where is the difference here? You're following.
Here I'm following him, here I'm not.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, because it's inside of that. All right, let's run it.
So you'll notice it's failing, followed tweets, fails. And actually we've got another one that fails too. Because so you'll notice like we don't have a follow method yet,
And we don't have a followed tweets method yet. So I wrote examples in the way that I want my code to look like. I want to say that a natural API for saying that one user follows another one is instead of going through, instead of creating a relationship directly like I did in Cucumber, I'd rather say that, you know, I just tell this one user to follow the other one. And so by writing that in the example, now I've specified the API that I want, and now I can go ahead and implement that. That said, I've got this follow method, and we're going to want to put some behavior around that, such as I can't follow myself, I can't have multiple follows. So as soon as we get done with this, we kind of make a mental note that, okay, we've introduced this new method, that's gonna need some testing on its own to make sure that it's robust. So we'll go through, get these examples finished, and then we'll go ahead and spec out the follow method to include that behavior that we want.
In the same way that we were just doing this one. Go ahead.
Do you have anything in there to prevent you from following yourself?
That's gonna be a unit test that is gonna be in the association level that we were talking about. So to prevent from following someone more than once and to prevent us from following ourselves, because that would just be, you know, narcissistic. And nobody liked that joke.
Okay, so let's see. Does this make sense?
Has many... Nah, no, 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 no.
That's not what I'm trying to do.
You're in the user.
I'm the user.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say.
Has many followed tweets through.
So I need to say has many followers.
Yeah.
No, has many follows.
Follows.
Right?
Yeah. You don't need that there.
Foreign key. I do need that.
Yep.
I say, I guess this is on the follow
E,
right?
_ ID. Yep.
Right, because I am. No, I'm the follower.
Follower.
See, okay, so we're trying to figure. Okay, so I kind of named the follow stuff what made sense when I originally created it, but now we're having some trouble figuring out what the actual keys are. So I would say that, you know, we'll get this working, but then it'd be a good opportunity to change it. But the other beautiful thing about testing it the way we're doing it is we can get it wrong here. You know, I can say followee ID here, and if my tests are, you know, say that the tweets are empty, I just change it to follower, and then, you know, that'll probably be right. So it's one or the other. I'm not entirely sure which, but my test will let me know in a few seconds. And it's not as, it's
class name?
No, it's not going to be class name because it has to go through the tweets association.
That should be...
It's Josh Susser comes up first, of course.
Of course.
Instead of... Did that just take us to the very back?
Yeah. Go to Rails API. We'll find it here. Yeah. Browse online. That's what we're on, right?
Three.
And then,
source,
and then
the association.
Yeah. Wait, no, follows.
No, we're trying to get the tweets through the follows, and then it's saying that the source is the tweets association on it.
Wow. Okay.
Could not find the source association tweets. Oh, yeah. You know what? Because we need to do like a double has many through. I need to say has many
something else
followed users through
right
follows
right
right and then I don't know, I guess that source is what.
See, I'm a little trying trying to. Can we go see the what do you call it? That one. So this is a table that has a follower ID and a followee ID, right? And they're both user IDs. So a user has many followers, and a user has many followees. And you follow. So what are we calling that?
So we just want to say, the followed users is what I'm trying to get now, which is like the followees, right? But I think it makes more sense. Like, I'm trying to look at the people that I follow. So it's the followed users.
Followed users, yeah.
Yeah.
It's all tricky how you name these things. Okay.
So it's a double many-to-many through on yourself.
Yes, that's what
right. We're doing. That's what's tricky about it, because we're in the same.
So we could very easily reach the limit. I mean, we could get into that kind of black hole of self-referential has many through times two. We'll find out. Okay.
See, I still don't think we need that source there, because if we change number three,
followees.
Right, so if we change has many follows, right? If we add two has many follows and then we do two has many throughs, right? One that says the follow ID, followee ID, and then the next one will be whatever we call it with the foreign key of follower ID.
Oh, well, I don't care about finding the people that follow me yet.
Yeah, but if it's going to work for both, I think it's just has many follows.
Yeah, so right now, like, I don't care about who follows me. I'm just trying to figure out, you know, who my followed users are, like who I'm following. Right. So I think what we do is we say this is getting a little bit complex for doing the tweets. We realize that there's a whole second join in there. So let's mark those first examples pending and just spec out followed users and get that working.
Right.
And then we can go through the next one.
I'm with you.
Now so you'll notice I marked those as pending, so now they're just kind of ignored for the time being. So we said, hey, that's getting too tough. Let's take something a little simpler at this point. Let's just do this.
I remember doing this a long time ago, trying to figure out the naming conventions and these things, and followed users and who you follow, who follows you. It's always kind of confusing. Subject. Naming something. Who is it? Ken Beck that said, name it something horrible so you come back and actually think about it.
Right, like, yeah, ridiculous stuff. Like, I am too stupid to figure out the actual name of this method. And then at some point, you will be so upset about the name of that method that you'll come back and figure out what to name it.
Yeah. Okay. So,
all right.
Subject dot followed users should include
user. Users.
All right.
Now let's go and add that. Expected something to include nothing.
So I'm gonna guess that it was the other way.
Just get rid of the source for now. Through something source, yeah, you're right. Is it one
of followee
or follower?
Should be.
Followee, right?
I would think so. Follow.create, follower is the subject.
Uh-huh.
Follower is the user.
Yeah, that's right.
Right.
Let's put a debugger on where? I guess in the spec.
There's only two freaking sources for this to go. Okay. So I don't know. Let's go to
there.
Oh, you know what? We still need to have that.
bitching about the association I saw. It just doesn't actually work.
What do you mean?
Wait a minute, do we not have any follows? Didn't I just do P follow all here? Oh, there we go. Okay. So my follower ID. My followee ID.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. The follower should have user. Oh, because subject's not created at that point. Right?
Oh, yeah. Let's make it a let bang and then just set the. This is one of the beauties of RSpec 2. So let's say, or call it me or something, you know. All right, and then, yeah. Whee! Ta-da!
Okay, so the follower is one,
yeah.
Follower is two.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right, now we have
to follow users. And the source would be the followee. Uh-huh.
User ID 2. Expected empty array to include something. Let's go back to the test. Follower me. Me.follow. Users. Can you print out? Yeah.
Okay. So I'm one, you're two, mm-hmm. I'm following two.
Follow. Oh, no. You're following.
Yeah, one follows
yeah,
two.
That looks right.
That's what we want.
What are we missing? Can you say me.reload maybe? Just I mean it's bad, but just see what happens.
Right. Nope. Nope.
Let's go ahead. Let's see the original.
Wait, we have follows, right?
Yeah.
Oh
that
wait
might
a minute.
Be a problem. Follower.
Yeah, let's see what's going on here, because I say p me dot.
Do row that follows.
I bet row has a bunch of follows, right? So we look there. I've got no follows. So we're back to where we were, but because we went into the whole looking at tweets thing, we kind of
forgot the whole this might be an R instead.
Right. And we don't need to reload.
Right.
So get rid of all that junk. Yeah.
Sweet.
Nice.
Okay, so now...
What did you do just to fix where you were?
Say what?
What did you do just now?
Again, it was, it's you know, kind of wrapping your mind around the fact that the follow, if you go to the follow model, you'll see that there's, both of those are pointing back to the user, right? And so just getting it clear in your mind which one you're trying to figure out when in that particular test was killing us. So in this case, follows, the foreign key was us, right? The instantiated object's ID.
Right, and so you'll remember like as we wrote the initial spec for the test or for tweets saying like, what are the followed tweets? I was like, well, you know, this foreign key might be follower ID or it might be followee ID, I'm not sure. Then we started writing the tweets. We saw it was getting a little bit complex, so we stopped focusing on tweets and just went to followed users. And at that point, because we're getting into this so much, we had totally forgotten that, hey, we might want to change followee to follower here. So I think it's obvious that over time we would want to change the names and foreign keys of these to make it simpler.
Something worse.
But, you know, still took what? Somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes. Which sucks, actually, for setting up an association.
Yeah.
I'm just a little confused about how much of this stuff actually has schemas in the database at this point. Is it all?
Oh, it all does. So, right, okay, so what we're actually, this follow stuff is technically not a unit test at all, and they're going to be relatively slow because they do create stuff in the database. So in this followed users record, we originally create the me record, then we create a second user to follow, and then we create a third record in the database, which is the actual follow. And then finally, we follow it up. I shouldn't say we follow it up. Finally, the next thing we do is do a query from the database. So all of this is hitting the database. This is just sort of how, you know, this is how Active Record works, right? It's based entirely on the database and SQL databases. So for certain parts of your app and your test suite, you can mock and stub the hell out of it and get a nice, fast, isolated test suite. And other stuff, you just have to test through the database because Active Record is so coupled to it. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. That's just the way it is. Over time, it's best, I think, if you move this stuff into a separate directory, or with RSpec 2, you can use tags to filter it out and basically say these are database examples, so they're slower. So you can run, you know, you can run your in-memory ones very, very quickly without without slowing down your whole test suite. Because as you have, you know, 50, 100, 200 of these for all your models in your application, then your test suite's going to slow down big time.
All right, so moving right along to the
tweets.
The tweets now. Should be a different error.
So we have no method follow, right, on user.
Right.
So we'll start off with that.
Follow. Wait, just do it on follow users, right? That create.
So what do we say here?
Yeah, just like that.
What do we pass in?
That's it, because it already fills up the other stuff with your stuff.
Cool.
Because that's what we told it. Does that make sense to everybody, what we did there?
Unknown attribute following.
Go to follow?
No, you know what, this...
No, we can't do followed users because that actually creates a user. Right, and we're just trying to create a follow.
Tweets through.
Follow users, yeah?
I have no idea if this is going to work because we are now saying we're doing has many through back to our table and then going through that association onto the tweets table. So this is the part where it may all blow up and we call the example over.
Wow. Double in or join.
I think if you get rid of the follow, the foreign key, it might work.
On.
See, because now you're using the same follows for.
Yeah, we're still using the follower ID. But I think we need to create a separate line three that, whatever we call it. No.
Are you using two instance variables?
We're doing the simplest thing that could possibly work.
Yes. There you go. Ta-da! We can come back and refactor. Red, green, refactor.
Right, and on it, okay, so obviously, I mean, none of this would scale at Twitter level, obviously, right? So, but what we did here is we said, hey, doing an inner join and another inner join and on the same table is painful. We don't care about the performance of that query right this second. What we're trying to do is build a feature that we can demo to our customer. And then we will, you know, over the next week or before we go to production, we will basically tell the database guy, hey, you figure out what the query should be for us. Or, you know, we spend more time on it. But at this point, we can just say, you know, look up our followed users, get their tweets, and join them. So, you know, we could do, you know, as the next bit, what we could do is order by the created at date so that we actually have everything in there. In fact, you know, why don't we do that?
Yeah. And we can, yeah, let's go.
Because follow tweets should include our own tweets too.
Yeah.
Because we want it to
right.
be on our homepage.
Our stream, that's right.
Right?
Yeah.
So let's see. It includes my own tweets. It sorts tweets.
By. Yeah.
At.
And.
Okay. So, yeah. And why don't we say this? So describe when following another user.
That's where I'll put the context instead of describe.
I like it. So context is an alias for describe. Doesn't matter which one you use. Sometimes. Yeah, and I agree with Ro in this case, it's more readable to say, like, now we're kind of tightening the context here. Okay, so I don't need to do that. Let's make sure we're still green. Okay.
All right. So... let's write in the before block, let's write another tweet. Oh, inside of that one. Gotcha. Yeah. Oh, we need it there.
Yeah, I'm okay with duplicating.
Yeah. Equals.
Okay, so this might trip you guys out a little bit. What we're doing in this case is this operator here basically says we can check the contents of a collection without caring what the ordering is. So it's basically set comparison. So in this case, we haven't specified any kind of ordering. I could also say that it should include both of those, but in this case, you know, I know that it only includes those. So yeah, but I don't know. I mean that. Let's we'll change it to include because sometimes that can really mess with people.
Right, and let's wait for this one to pass or fail.
Yeah,
right. And you can see it's expecting something and.
So it expected both tweets, but it only got one, right? Because now we're only looking through our followed users. But now I can just append our own tweets to it.
And again,
good to go.
Something that we were read, we made it pass, and then we'll come back and refactor it later. And this basically is the same.
Yeah, now we're just checking ordering. So, and it's going to be in reverse chronological order, right? So.
So can you tell me why you didn't want to put in the before?
Because
it'll
do it three times. We didn't do it here.
Right.
I mean.
Okay.
So honestly, like after we do this, after we write the second example and get it working, I would probably go back and delete that middle one that we did because it's testing more or less the same thing. You know, I know that it includes it by virtue of this test. I guess the only reason to keep it around is in case somebody comes through and changes how the sorting works, you know, and that's another aspect of the behavior, right? That it contains my own tweets, and then a separate aspect of the behavior is that they are in a particular order.
And in this case, we're just gonna, yeah, make sure that it's an array and that it's exactly the right order.
Okay.
And it.
Cool. So now they're flipped because we found the other tweets first and then mine.
Oh. Wow. Hacktacular. But it works. Cool.
All right, so I guess at this point, you know, there's two paths we can take. One is to spec out the follow example a little bit more and put those conditions on the associations. I think that first thing that we want to do is just get that scenario passing and get that green, and then we can go back and tighten up any of the stuff that we have. We're going to run out of time here, so I'd like to get that scenario done first and then... we'll leave the rest as an exercise to you guys.
Yep. So let's go back to the feature.
Yes. Finally, back to here.
Alright. So now, when I go to my homepage, which was, if you look at paths, done by TweetsBath. And say user.find.me.
Do we have that?
Yes.
Oh, gotcha.
Because we set that
right.
up in
yeah.
here.
Mm-hmm.
So cookies user
name.
Dot follow tweets. So we, in doing that, we broke one of our examples because now we've specified that, like, now that we've introduced accounts, you can't really just go to your homepage unless you have an account. So we have to update our tweets controller example to return a user. Actually, all we did was change the finder. We changed the finder on user, right? So
the controller test, we need to just.
Stub out user.
Yeah, should receive.
So we'll say.
Something different. All right. And normally, what you would do here is you would have some sort of plugin like device or clearance or auth logic that would give you a current user. And then you would stub out controller.stub current underscore user, and then you would do whatever there that you need to do. So.
Oh no, we can't set cookies. Expected row.
Don't you have to say controller? Man. Cookies.
I'm just gonna do this. Ah, what happened there?
Text mate, that's what happened there.
True story.
So
now I want to say look up user and return.
User.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so I don't know if you guys, I moved kind of quickly, but I did a little bit of a trick here, which is that we are, you know, we want to look up the username via the cookies. And actually, I'd prefer to do session, but just because of the way we set up Cucumber, session wasn't available at the very beginning, so we went through the cookies instead. And so when stuff gets, but then cookies aren't available at the beginning of an RSpec thing, or I don't know the exact syntax for it at that point and didn't want to mess around with it. So what I did was I know the code that I need to look up a user by the cookie, so I just extracted that to a method on the controller, and then in my example, I stub out that method. So, you know, you'll hear a lot of the time that you don't want to stub methods on the object that you're testing, but in this case, I'm basically just setting up some login state, and I, like Ro said, I would be using clearance or something like that anyway. So that's just kind of a little trick, like to extract a bit of code, stub it out, and then let the integration test make sure that everything works together.
Right.
So I think we should be good.
Nothing. Oh, because we're doing the cookies.
Didn't we set that up? Cookies username.
Okay, you guys are totally going to hate me for what I'm about to do. But like I said, we would be using some kind of authentication framework. And we could absolutely get this working with the cookies or the session, but I don't know what the method names are off the top of my head and how to set it up. So don't shoot me, and keep in mind this is just an example. We are going to set up the username in a global variable.
Oh no. Kill me now.
No, it's a global variable.
Oh my gosh.
See, Ruby global variables are so unused in Ruby that Ruby programmers don't even know what the syntax for them is, which is a good thing.
I'm proud of that.
It's a good thing. Be proud.
So green over here? Yes. Oh, wait. Okay, so
the other thing that we, well, I said that we're going to include the tweet's username in there. So that's why it's failing. And we could do some cool stuff on, actually, let's just do it.
All right. You.
We're going to do some more nasty stuff. But I'm just showing you like cool Ruby stuff that we can do to get stuff passing at this point.
And we're running out of time.
Right. So
I see why BJ volunteered me for this.
Let's see. When following another user, it includes the user's name in the tweet body. So say
me dot.
Let's see. Me dot followed tweets dot first
should include
body should equal this is Rose tweet at row.
Failing.
Right, so see, when I look up somebody else's tweet, it doesn't include the name yet. So I'm going to go in and extend the tweets on the fly, which is something that you would not want to do. But for purposes of this example, it's fun.
So you're going to go on.
Right. You want to like alias method chain this?
Oh my gosh. we could, yeah, we're going to reopen it, right?
Yes. No, I just want to do this. I don't have to do that. Def tweet dot body read body plus
name.
Oh, does this belong to a user? I assume
user.
It'll say
that user
undefined method, so that should be read attribute.
And shouldn't that be user?
Well, we're inside of tweet.
Oh,
so
user.
At this point,
yeah,
I should
yeah,
just
yeah.
say
gotcha.
It doesn't know
yeah.
what a user is.
Right.
So you go to tweet, belongs to user. Okay. Let's run all of our examples. There we go.
Nice. By the way, this is dirty. Ta-da! All
right.
We have a debug statement somewhere.
Yeah. We'll live. Okay, so next up, run spec cucumber. Make sure that everything is good. I'm not going to load this stuff in the browser because our tests are great. We know it works, except for all that.
Except for when they don't. Look up user. Yeah. You have to set it on those other ones, too.
Which one? Where are these?
My Twitter stream.
My Twitter stream feature. Oh, set when I go to my home page. Okay, right. So my Twitter stream. Background, given I am logged in as DJ. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, did we not include my tweets on that? User. No, it should be right.
I actually see. That one item's got zero. Oh, go back to that definition, that step definition.
Okay, tweet steps.
Look what's yours. That's the one.
Not oh, yeah. Okay, I'm going to say I don't actually care about this feature for the time being. This is one that we could spend a few minutes to fix, but we're over our time now. Obviously, we'd want to get that working, but we did add accounts, so that means that we're going to need to change a little bit of the stuff around, some of the existing setup. I'm not entirely sure what it is, and I'm really tired, but I hope that that this has been instructive for you guys. Towards the end, we did some stuff that you would pretty much never do in a production application, and by pretty much never, I mean absolutely never, but it was fun, and it helped us get to our green scenario so that we could actually start to demo stuff. And then at that point, once we've got those tests in place, we can go back, we can add unit tests for some of the other behavior that we needed, like the follows, and we can refactor so that we are, you know, using a nice database query instead of doing all the stuff in memory, which wouldn't work for, I don't know, 10 million tweets or whatever.
Or even 1,000.
Or even 1,000. So wrapping up here, you know, we got follows working and followed tweets, so I'm happy about that in the, you know, 3 hours of talking. Any questions about what we did so far or comments or anything?
Mine is the last 10 minutes. Bueller? No? All right.